Welcome once again to Cinematic Obsessions, and please welcome my guests, Ted Okuda and Mark Yurkiw.
Close enough.
Okay. Right. It's actually with a W, but it sounded like a V when you told me.
Yeah, the Germans did that.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a long story.
But they are the authors of the book, The Shock, From Shock Theater to Svengoolie. And those of us who grew up in Chicago and watched some television... remember watching Creature Feature, maybe you remember watching Son of Svengoolie, and then later on Elvira, and we're going to talk about all that in your book. First I want to talk a little bit about you guys. You guys have some very interesting biographies in comedy, and Ted, you did some writing for some science fiction books.
Well, just assorted books on movies, and then these last couple I've done are specifically more geared to television.
Okay.
But usually, it's just kind of obscure film.
Well,
films that aren't written about.
I don't know if you can read the quote, but I have a great quote here about you. And it starts out, during my generally misspent youth. Now, I don't know if you can say the quote. If you can't, that's fine. But can you, do you remember the quote?
Approximately, so during my generally misspent youth, I spent a lot of time watching a lot of films.
The most preposterous movies.
Preposterous movies ever made. And I use the word preposterous advisedly, because you know, these they deal with werewolves and giant turtles and huge insects. So, but I don't have any regrets about that, because I had a lot of fun. That was a fun part of childhood.
Grasshoppers as big as a shit aquarium,
right?
Puppet people, humongous leeches, killer shrews,
teenage werewolves,
woman, fire-breathing space turtles. I don't remember that one. Big alien brains.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you're right. And giant scorpions. I think it's a great quote. And they're, and then you're also in the comedy field. Is that correct?
Well, if that's a matter of opinion, I guess. But yeah, I you know, have done some performing with a couple of improv groups, and did some cable access stuff, and things like that. Just get up on stage and, you know, just, you know, you place yourself in the hands of your audience. You know, you're at their mercy to, you know, they throw something up at you and you've got to work with it. And
now,
it can be pretty challenging.
Ted, you're more of a film historian, but you're described more as a journalist. Is that fair to say?
Well, I do. I write for a local paper in the suburbs, the Riverside Brookfield Landmark. And that's, you know, mostly, yeah, I mean, my background is in writing.
Well, I should also add, though, that I do a lot of research on movies, you know, the corporate histories and all that. Mark is a real whiz in TV history, particularly local television history.
I don't know if that's something to brag about, but, you know.
Including the golden age of children's television.
Yeah, that's a book that Ted wrote with Jack Mulqueen, who was part of the golden age of Chicago children's television.
Kitty a Go-Go.
Kitty a Go-Go.
But Mark was very helpful on that book.
It was on Cable Access Network. Kitty a Go-Go is a show here.
Well, that's Chick a Go-Go. That's based on Kitty a Go-Go.
Okay, yeah. Chick a Go-Go.
Kitty a Go-Go was...
at the Porges Theater.
Well, that was the Chick a Go-Go movie that they spawned up. But Chick a Go-Go, which is Cable Access show, openly admits that it was inspired by Jack Mulqueen's show, Kitty Go-Go.
It's Jake Austin's homage to...
Now, just a question on trivia, and we'll get back to the book, and but is it? There's two stories about two children's. And since I just had a show on the military, I'm a captain in the Army Reserve. Mm-hmm. That Captain Kangaroo was like an award-winning military. I don't know if he was a Navy SEAL, but now is this urban legend, as many things are, or was Captain Kangaroo some kind of high-level military?
Well, that story started. Lee Marvin was on the Tonight Show.
Yeah.
When Johnny mm-hmm. Carson was the host, and related that story, and subsequently it's been refuted as urban legend, but okay. it's passed along. So often that it's like the old saying.
So you're saying it has been refuted about Captain Kangaroo being, I was Marine Recon or Special
right.
Forces.
He was in the service. Okay. But Lee Marvin cited a particular instance where he led a group of men single-handedly up a hill or something like that, and he tended to embellish that. I think Marvin and Captain Kangaroo, whose name was Bob Keeshan, were in the same unit. But Marvin loved to just tell a tall tale. So.
Okay, but Captain Kangaroo was a honored veteran, though?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now the other one was that Cap, the Reverend, Mr. Rogers, was a Navy SEAL, and that he had tattoos on his forearms, and that's why he wore the long sweaters. Now, is that true, or is that a urban legend?
That one I've never been able to pin down. I've heard stories supporting both.
Okay.
So right now I'd say that's still kind of in a gray area, but I don't want to discount it.
Okay.
Let's say I'd like to believe it.
But he was a Presbyterian minister.
Yes.
And I believe he also was in the service.
Yes.
Okay. That is confirmed. Well, anyway, but today we're here to talk about horror. And I think it's a great topic. As a kid, I loved horror movies. And this is another part of your biography. You are the Grand Sheik?
Yes. Okay. Of the Chicago Bacon Grabbers, which is the local...
Sons of the Desert.
Of the Sons of the Desert, yes.
Which is the Laurel and Hardy
Appreciation Society. I think that's the...
Now, for those of you who don't know who Laurel and Hardy was, black and white. And now, forgive me if I'm wrong, because I'm, as you said, the Europeans know better. And I have watched many Laurel and Hardy movies. But one is silent. One does not speak, right? Do I got the right one going here? No.
Oh, no. You think of that probably Harpo Marx.
No. Right. I thought Laurel Hardy one was, I thought it was like a straight guy and the funny guy.
Well, one is kind of straighter than the other, although he's still kind of a comedian. And
well, actually, they don't speak very much sometimes.
Yeah, they're mostly into pantomime. We made mm-hmm. silent films.
Because I thought one was even silent, where the chubbier one was the talker. And it was black and white, which...
Oh, yes, yeah.
Okay.
But, I mean... Right. Stan tended to be a little quiet, but he wasn't mute. Mm-hmm.
Well, not completely. I mean, he didn't have a whole lot to say, usually.
Okay.
And when he did, it kind of...
Their comedy was mainly visual anyway. Yes. So.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I thought the one was mute, but I am familiar. Now, because in the what some people think was the golden age of cinema, when it was not spoken, and there's actually, he's a medievalist and a traditional Catholic, Daniel Mitsui, who's Japanese by descent, but traditional Catholic by vocation. He's an artist. He has written things on his blog, The Lion and the Cardinal, which I've read, and some very fascinating stuff. He does not believe that spoken movies are good. So he likes certain types of cartoons, and I'm not sure all of the philosophical basis, but he only likes the non-spoken movies. And when we had Joe Rubin, who's from Odd Inception and a film historian, and I guess he's done porn film history, he's done blaxploitation film history, he said that there is a school of thought that the pantomime... the non-verbal movies are somehow a superior form of art.
Maybe superior in a spiritual sense also?
Perhaps, an aesthetic sense, mm-hmm. an artistic sense, a visual sense,
I don't
know.
There's more of a universality to that. I mean, Laurel and Hardy made mm-hmm. silent films and sound mm-hmm. films, and to this day, even their fans and historian argue which ones are better. There's a camp mm-hmm. that prefers the silent films.
Mm-hmm. And Charlie Chaplin.
Oh, yeah, of course. But, you know, there really doesn't have to be, I mean, you can perform and you can entertain people and you don't really have to say a lot, you know. And I think things have gotten to a point where people have gotten used to a certain kind of entertainment, and they've gotten used to, well, you have to have this and you have to have that, and people have to be dressed a certain way, and they have to, you know, behave a certain way, and they're kind of locked into this.
Well, briefly on comedy, then we'll get to the book and horror movies, mm-hmm. and I have a good way to segue into it, I remember Son of Paleface by Bob Hope, mm-hmm. which was a great comedy, I thought. It was clean. It wasn't all the sexual humor. Mm-hmm. That humor today is overly sexualized, certainly maybe after the 70s or the 80s. And that you had physical comedy or physical entertainment that you saw with, Fred Astaire mm-hmm. or even Frank Sinatra in some of it,
right.
or mm-hmm. Abbott and Costello, that is absent today, with the exception maybe of Jim Carrey. Mm-hmm. That the humor was in the, or Dean Martin and you said your friend,
Jerry Lewis,
Jerry
yeah.
Lewis who you mm-hmm. said you know. So you had that Jerry Lewis, very physical humor that he didn't even have to say a word, and it caused laughter by the audience.
Right, and that's, when someone does that, and when someone can do that now, I really admire that, because I think I've done a lot of improv, and I've done a lot of performing in front of audiences, and a lot of that has been in bars. And, you know, trying to do improv with people that have been drinking is quite challenging, to say the least, because it isn't going to be real intellectual, you know.
Well, you know, let me segue that into the horror movies. When I was a boy, I used to like Abbott and Costello, and I remember there was Abbott and Costello meets the Mummy. I think
and
Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein. Mm-hmm. I think they meet Dracula. I thought when I was a kid, I haven't seen them in years, but Abbott and Costello were very funny. I loved them. When I say a kid, I mean 5, 6, 7, even 4. Mm-hmm. I can go back and remember that far, maybe mm-hmm. even earlier, but fairly small little boy. And they had the humor and the horror movies.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I remember, I think some of them were even on Son of Svengoolie, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, yes, they made the rounds to most mm-hmm. of the horror shows, local horror mm-hmm. shows.
And, you know, the interesting thing about that is that they were at the same studio where a lot of those were made, and they had some of the same people, you know. So they had the real monsters, it wasn't so much that they were doing a parody of it, but it was almost like they became part of it themselves, you know, because they were right there.
Now, going to the Chicago base, which I think your book's about, well, tell me a little bit about your book.
Well, it's about Chicago-based programming.
Right.
Because...
Creature feature.
Right. Particularly in the earlier days, you didn't have network television programming 24/7. So during certain portions of the day, local stations had to come up with their own programming. And that resulted in the kids' shows. Mm-hmm. And they would get movie packages to show locally. Mm-hmm. And in those, when these things first started out, a lot of them are considered classics now. But in those days, they were just crummy horror movies, so they were trying to figure out, well, how are we going to get people to watch this?
Well, I had read in some of the materials that they were dumping, that initially Hollywood was very fearful of TV, that TV could
right.
put an end to movies, feature-length movies. However, then they viewed it as an ally, and they started to dump all the movies that never made it to the big screen, or maybe was briefly on the big screen, to TV.
Right. This was kind of like dead product to the major studios.
So what might be B movies today that you see that come on Showtime late at night, but you've never seen in the movie theaters?
Right. Right. And then now you have like Turner Classic Movies. Now they're considered classics. Mm-hmm. 50 years ago, they were just these old movies that they had to figure out some way to get people to watch.
Okay. It was product. It was, you know, here's 20 pounds of film, you know, do something with it. And that was a way of kind of presenting it and punching it up in a way that would make it more interesting.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I remember some of the non-horror features, you would have the children's classics.
Oh, the family classics.
The family yeah. classics, mm-hmm. Robinson Crusoe or Huckleberry Finn. I can even remember the, wasn't there a goose that talked or something?
Oh, Garfield Goose.
Garfield mm-hmm. Goose. And
we just kind of clacked away.
Yeah, and then who was the gentleman? He had the books, all the classic books, Robinson Crusoe.
Oh, Frasier Thomas.
Same guy as Garfield mm-hmm. Goose.
Yeah, yeah, Frasier Thomas. But then on the horror side, you had Creature Feature. And then, we're talking about Abbott and Costello juxtaposing humor and horror. That always seems to be connected to horror movies.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps mm-hmm. taken to an extreme in the scary movie later
oh,
on.
Sure, but a lot of so-called regular horror films have some element of humor in them.
Yes, so. Without a doubt. And let's talk about those a little bit, and then we got a clip that we want to take a look at. So, Creature Feature. How did it start? What was some of the movies they play? Why does Creature Feature? It's a good rhyming name, but mm-hmm. why does it take such a part of Chicago imagination and history?
Well, that was everybody that we've talked to that was their Saturday night, Friday night.
Of a certain generation,
right.
Yeah.
It was a ritual.
It was on from 1970 to 1976. So, it grabbed the core audience.
And you were saying, I remember, because I'm old enough to remember that there was a time where you saw fuzz on the TV.
Oh, yeah.
Or the American flag and,
People forget that, I guess, today's generation, I don't realize that.
It was never 24/7 programming.
No, they would have, what I remember is the sign-off, as they would call it. The
National anthem.
The national anthem. And then some stations before that would have this little thing called your FBI report, where they would show you the top five wanted FBI felons in the neighborhood. And then they'd go to the national anthem, kind of an odd segue.
Well, the last time I saw it in a major movie, I don't know if you remember, it's not a horror movie, Tom Cruise's Risky Business.
Okay.
But when the girl comes over, then it's actually playing the national anthem. And by the time he falls asleep, then it was the sign-off.
Yeah, and that's the way it would go. They would play the national anthem, and it'd be this big regal thing with photography by the Sierra Club and all these, nature scenes and flags and all this, and then that would, be real majestic, and it would fade out, and then there'd be a black thing for about 5 seconds, and then, it would just go to
fuzz.
Static. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Creature Feature is remembered, like you said, I remember it, and I think it even predated me. I could be wrong. And then I remember as a kid, Son of Svengoolie, and the thing I remember the most was, of course, the makeup and the hat, but that he'd say, Berwyn.
Right,
yes.
Okay. I never understood what the meaning of that was, and as a young person, I didn't even know where Berwyn was at the time. What was Berwyn?
Berwyn was and is an old community in the west suburbs with a lot of, it used to be highly, Eastern European.
Bohemian Czech.
It's more Hispanic.
There's still a significant Bohemian Czech population.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, that was taken from, there was a fellow in Cleveland. His name was Ernie Anderson. He was on the air as Goulardi. And there were, Cleveland had a small little suburb that he used to like to make fun of called Parma. And on his show, he'd go, Parma? So what happened was the original Svengoolie, Jerry G. Bishop, during those years, the early 60s, he was a disc jockey in Cleveland. So when he came here and started the Screaming Yellow Theater, that was the original showcase for Svengoolie, he wanted to do something like that. So he just chose Berwyn. So instead of Parma, it was Berwyn, and it just stuck.
Now, another thing that stuck out of my mind, I think I was not quite a teenager when it happened, that was the most anticlimactic thing since Geraldo Rivero raided Al Capone's vault.
Oh, you found nothing. Revenge of the Creature.
Right? The creature from the Black Lagoon, mm-hmm. and everybody was going to 7-Eleven, and they were buying, or maybe it was Whitehead, I think it was 7-Eleven, mm-hmm. and you were buying the 3D glasses, and everybody was expecting a real 3D movie. And I remember going, and I remember having I think my dad didn't want to buy them because he was what we call polite frugal, but maybe called cheap, and he didn't want to buy the glasses. And I think my grandmother bought it, or somebody doted on me, and it was nothing.
I remember that night, yeah.
And it was a big disappointment, and people were like throwing them down, and they were real ticked off. And I don't know if that was the decline of that Svengoolie, but it certainly was a moment in my childhood memories, and a moment, I think, in horror movies, because since then you have not really seen a 3D movie push. And to my knowledge, I don't even know if you really do. I see science fiction movies where you have people playing arcade games with that, and I see even kids, there's places you have some kind of 3D, but there's been no 3D movies that I'm aware of.
Well, there was right around that same time, there was, I think, wasn't it called Coming At You? It was like
an Italian or Spanish.
In the early 80s or something, but at that time they were going to do this big promotion, and they had all the stuff they were going to do. There was a couple of Three Stooges shorts that they had done in 3D when they had the original 3D craze in the early 50s when they did things like House of Wax and stuff like that, and they were going to start promoting that, but when it didn't really translate well. Now, I remember WGN running a John Wayne movie in 3D after that, maybe 10 years later,
and it still didn't really.
Yeah, and I even taped that, and I think I remember my brother-in-law, I think it depended on where you were, what kind of set you had or what kind of signal you had, and I think he said when the creature was on that, when it was on the air, he could see it in 3D, but I think when you played the tape back, that the effect was gone.
Well, the technology that you would use for showing 3D movies in a theater, that usually works well, because it's completely different. But then for the, particularly back in, what was that, 1982, to run Revenge of the Creature, even now the technology for TV isn't really there yet, despite, you know, all this Blu-ray and HD. Last Halloween, Regis and Kelly did a special Halloween 3D broadcast.
Right. Uh-huh.
And I watched it just out of curiosity, and it's a little slicker. Some of the stuff worked, but a lot of it didn't. So here we are all these years later, and it still doesn't really translate.
A few years from now, they're going to probably do, what, holographic, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, you mentioned the Three Stooges, who, as Randall Sherman, who's treasurer of our organization, points out, they were all Lithuanian Jews.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe even related to Randy Sherman in some way. But they were fantastic humorists, physical humor. Mm-hmm. But they also did a number of horror movies themselves.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So there was another juxtaposition of horror and comedy. And you've done some research into that. Or did you? Because I read all the stuff, so I don't. If I say Ted and I mean Mark, I apologize.
Well, research sounds better. It makes it kind of respectable.
We both have. Yeah, we both have on the Stooges. Right. That's a even though you're a Laurel and Hardy advocate, acknowledge the other teams.
Oh, yeah, of course.
They don't get into fights with the Three Stooges advocates. So.
Not anymore. although every time I've run a Stooge short at a bag and grabbers function, it's like, you know, they don't throw things, but it's like, you know.
There's some grumbling.
Well, I remember when I was in high school and I went to Loyola Academy in the mid-'80s, lived the late-'80s, that we used to run Stooges Week or during lunchtime, after lunch you could go, and they were very popular.
Oh, yeah.
And there were some excellent Three Stooges shows.
And it's ironic how things have turned out, because in the last 20, 30 years, the Stooges, which never really got any kind of critical acclaim in their lifetime, or they're getting it now posthumously, but years ago, Chaplin was the king, you know, Buster Keaton, Harold Lloyd, Laurel and Hardy, and now you've got a generation that maybe only knows the Stooges.
Well, they were barely even acknowledged. It was sort of like, you know, they were the redheaded stepchildren of Laurel and Hardy and maybe even Abbott and Costello, but I think what happened is that all these years went by and they were still on TV, and everybody knew them because they came home from school and sometimes it boggles my mind to think that I would come home from high school and the Three Stooges would be on in black and white on TV, and that's what we watched, you know. And now it's it goes a mile a second now with the, you know, technology, and something that's 2 years old wouldn't play, you know, now.
Well, we're going to run a clip in just a second, but just some of the movies I remember on Creature Feature were and Son of Svengoolie, and maybe later. But I remember a couple movies I liked were The Omen, The Howling. Although now The Howling, in retrospect, I thought it was an incredible film at the time. American Werewolf in London, which was later a theater film. The first Halloween, I think they kind of got silly subsequently, but then even some of the older the Bela Lugosi films, the original Dracula, although I thought the Francis Ford Coppola remake was good, and certainly the technology is same. So things you saw as a child, when you see them again as an adult on TV, they have changed. But what are some of the key movies? I mean, then you have, of course, the classics, Frankenstein,
Dracula, the Mummy,
Dracula,
the Invisible Man,
Invisible Man, Wolfman, the first Mummy. and they play in other movies, because I think it was in The Howling where they're showing when the gypsy starts singing and when the moon.
Oh, yes, they show the clips.
Clips. So in a lot of the movies that do the whatever it is, they in the last movie with Tom Cruise, The War of the Worlds, which was science fiction more than horror, but there is some juxtaposition again of science fiction and horror.
You've got a generation of filmmakers that grew up watching these films on TV.
Right.
So they were influenced. I mean, sometimes they're influenced shows, sometimes it doesn't, but for the most part, they will credit their.
And I remember I saw The Blob when I was a small child at the movie theater, and I was terrified.
Mm-hmm.
I was horrified of The Blob, even though now I would watch it and say, this is absurd, this is stupid, this is silly, because I had an uncle, his name's Richie, and he liked movies a lot, and he would run them once the VHS came out, or beta at first, I think, and then the movie theaters and The Blob. But what are some of the key movies? What are some of the movies in the clip? And then what do you think are some of the key movies that are almost archetypes of this genre of horror films?
Well, I would say the ones you mentioned, really, but And Ted would probably have more to say about this than me as a film historian, but...
you're pretty well versed.
But you also have multiple versions, so you have the classic Dracula, and then you have other versions of Dracula.
Exactly, yeah, so they all kind of spawn, they're all kind of interconnected.
And as a side note, you were here earlier, Ted, I don't know if you were here, Mark, we did a show on blaxploitation films, and that one of the subgenre of blaxploitation films were horror movies, such as Blackula.
Exactly.
So, which, you know, which again, I don't know, again, some of them are humorous, so is Blackula funny?
It has moments of humor, because it's, you know, when you got a title like Blackula,
right,
you can't help but poke a little fun at it.
And probably now more than then, But that's actually, you know, apart from a lot of them, you know, are regarded as classics and so forth, but, I mean, for me personally, some of my favorites are the ones that, you know, like the Ed Wood movies and, there's this one called The Creeping Terror, which the story on that is that this guy, it was no budget, basically, and he shot it, you know, on his own home equipment, and there's, for one day shooting, the audio didn't come out, so rather than reshoot it, he just narrated it. He added a narrator, and then there's this... they were like at a trailer park or something. Isn't it a trailer park?
And
this carpet attacks people, and it's a real hoop.
Well, one director we left out is Alfred Hitchcock.
Oh, of course.
I remember when I was a boy, I was very scared of The Birds. Mm-hmm. I thought it was a very scary movie. And, of course, he gets critical acclaim for Psycho, but really all of his films were very good. And I think he has a very interesting both film from a film point of view and philosophical premise.
Right. Now, his films were always considered prestige items, so they didn't wind up on... you know, horror shows, because Hitchcock, then and now, is a very recognizable name. So he was just considered, like, you know, too prestigious to just kind of fritter away.
But he did go on TV and was considered horror movies. Mm-hmm. Well, let's go to the clips and let's take a look, and we'll be right back.
Everybody, snap your fingers, or whatever you got. Close your coffin, lock your crypt, till the moon is bright. Don't go out in the day, till it's safe at night. Be careful when you fly.
Fly high.
Stay up in
the sky.
Watch for wind.
Here's why.
You'll take a dive and end up in Berwyn.
Berwyn.
Yes, watch Svengoolie every week. Keep your fangs pointy. Hey, good. Carry your blood, it belongs to me. Yes, music lover, yes. Svengoolie again with the program that asks the question, why is Timothy Leary, huh?
To say a book of baseball.
That's probably why. Listen, kids, how would you all like to see Svengoolie do an impersonation, huh? Would you like that, kids?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Listen, got to clear the deck a little bit here. See if you can guess who this is Svengoolie is impersonating. You ready? Okay. Who do you think it is, huh?
Is it Indian doing a war dance in high heels?
No, how do you say that without moving your lips? You don't have any lips. That's probably why. Move your lips, did you? Okay, good. Now you better take another guess, huh? Anybody? I'll tell you, it's the first man on the sun. You get it? See?
They watch it, but they don't get it.
Okay.
Well, hello there, pedestrian. Madman Sven here with another A1 hotsy-totsy abused car deal. That's a positive steal.
You ought to know. You stole it.
Yes, let Madman Sven take you off your feet. Put you flat on your back in this hardly driven. Factory reject, easy to own, tough to look at beauty. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the Spiffy. Little fanfare for it, huh? 1942, Cosa Nostra convertible, yes. The Cosa Nostra. Just look under the hood, and there's a hood.
Make them a deal they can't refuse, Svengoolie.
Forget, friend. This is a car with everything. For example, come around here with Madman Svengoolie. Listen to the radio in this car. I'll listen to that, huh? That's clear as a bell. Turn off the radio. Yes, and of course, listen to the horn on this great beauty. Listen, one more time, we'll blow it, and there it is, huh? Horn, okay. And you're asking, has this car got a heater, you ask, huh?
Hey, does that car have a heater?
You betcha. Listen, how's this for? Let me turn on the heater here. Takes a second to warm up. And, oh boy, how's that for heat? A little more, please. Okay. Yes, and for the hot summer months ahead, of course, stop already. It's got factory air. Factory air, if you like, breathing air from a factory. Huh? Okay, listen. And check, I don't know if you can see it through the smoke from the heater, but would you stop? Check the groovy ventilation system right there. Can you see that, huh? Look at that groovy, I can't see the cucumbers. groovy ventilation system, huh? Look how easily you can make the peace sign the cars with love it or leave it signs on.
That's right, Svengoolie.
And of course, car buyers, in the event of a breakdown, this car even has a jack in the trunk.
Of course, Svengoolie.
Shut up, Jack, and stay in here, will you please? Now Svengoolie knows what you're saying, car buyers. How can I afford a car like that? Well, listen, if you're poor, that doesn't bother us. If you're down on your luck, that doesn't bother us. If you're just a little short of bread, that doesn't bother us. If you're being sued by creditors because you're thousands of dollars in debt, that bothers us, huh?
That bothers us.
That's your life. And listen, Dingy, for customers who have no driver's license or who have had their driver's license revoked, Madman Sven has a special service. It's called, we won't tell if you won't. Yes, visit Madman Sven's Abused Car Emporium and Non-Union Dental Clinic. Conveniently located just out of the higher-end district, 612 miles from downtown Yuma, Arizona. Yes, Madman Sven, for yesterday's cars at tomorrow's prices. Madman Sven's Abused Cars, another marginally corrupt offshoot of Svengoolie's STD Enterprises. STD, Chef, Trickery, and Distributor Caps. This is Madman Sven, inviting you to come in today!
The educational part of the show, Svengoolie Street.
Get out of here, kids. Quiet, quiet. Well, hi there, future freaks, and welcome to Svengoolie Street, where every day is a learning experience. Every night, you run for your life. Today, we're going to look at the letter O.
Ow, ow, ow!
Not ow. The letter O. Got it?
Ooh.
Not O. See, there's the letter O. Hello. O, see? O, as you can see, is a very handy letter, boys and ghouls. O is the kind of a... Gordon, would you look out, you big dummy? O is the letter that begins all of these following words. Words like... Of. Huh? One of the big ones, O, see, is another word beginning with the letter O. Of course, the ever popular, I can't get it apart there. Another big word, it is of, off, out. another big word beginning with O is up. Huh? And of course, og, one of the famous words. And something I know your mommy said to you just the other day, oob, very popular word, of course, octoroon, which is the 10th cookie of the year. And of course, orc, which is a sea animal similar to a grampus. And of course, another big word that O begins with is octagon, huh? O also stands for accident.
That's funny. Today's Svengoolie Street was made possible by a grant from Cary. Get it? Cary Grant. You get to hear it? Okay.
Grab your shrouds, girls and boys. Here I come, making noise. I'm Svengoolie.
Bang, bang, bang.
Thank you. Creeping from my moldy vault. Don't blame me, it's not my fault. I'm Svengoolie. I'm the only one who's not forgotten. How to host those movies that are rotten.
So till you bury me again, come on, folks, welcome Svengoolie. That's me. It's the end of the song. Thank you very much. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I think Zelda is going to come in and ask me a question any time now, because, boy, have I got an answer prepared for her. Zelda, just
Steve,
come in. Yes.
Somebody told me you was in a hospital this week.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I had my appendix removed, and would you like to see my scar, huh? Zelda, would you like to see my scar?
Yeah.
You would, huh? Okay. Well, listen.
Wait a minute, girlie.
Yeah, the scar is here.
Anyway, what are you doing with a scar on your neck? The appendix is down around the stomach.
Well, I know you may find this hard to believe or to follow, but I was so ticklish they had to take out my appendix the long way. See? You get the humor there? Goodbye. And now, I know you're all dying to get back to the movie, right, huh? Because I know I'm dying here. There's another one. And now back to By the Blue, Mr. Magoo, Spiro Agnew, who? And Joanne Drew, with Valentine Janicki as Betty Hutton as a young pork chop in... What was that? I have no use for comedians, or Joan Rivers be damned. Get it? River, damn, get it?
Welcome back from those clips. That was the first Son of Svengoolie, right?
Well, his first Svengoolie.
Yes.
A fellow named Jerry G. Bishop. He had been a disc jockey, and he was an announcer for Channel 32.
Okay, so Svengoolie. So the later one that I'm more familiar with, Svengoolie, because I think this is even before my time. I noticed that the music is the same music that Quentin Tarantino used in Pulp Fiction and in From Dusk to Dawn. And Dusk to Dawn would be considered a horror movie, albeit outside of Tarantino's normal genre.
Yeah, that's a song called The Rumble by Link Ray and his Raymen from 50s, maybe? Early 60s?
Late 50s, early 60s.
Late 50s, 60s. Early
60s. Okay.
Yeah.
It just happened to be a favorite of Jerry G. Bishop. So
now, what were some of the movies they played at that time?
Well, on this particular incarnation of Svengoolie, Channel 9 had the classic Universal package for creature features, so they just got all the low-budget stuff. Bela Lugosi made a career out of making these like Poverty Row little pictures. And they got a lot of say Italian, Spanish produced films, Japanese films dubbed in English. Exactly. So he kind of got like what was considered.
So the Bela Lugosi were the Italian made films.
Well, no, Bela Lugosi made some low budget films here.
Okay.
For like independent producers.
And things like what was it, the?
Well, there were Italian horror films, right?
Oh, there were Italian horror films too that were. Not any recognizable stars in America, but you know, they were vampire and werewolf stories, so they were dubbed in English, and they released them here. You could get them a lot cheaper, because cheaper than the bigger name films.
But yeah, WGN, they were the big station on the block, and they pretty much bought up everything, you know, movies, TV shows, whatever, and the rest of these, like the UHF stations, they had to. Kind of take what was left over, which sometimes it wasn't much, but...
And these were on about the same time in the early 70s, and Creature Features didn't have a host. They just promoted the movies. The movies themselves could attract the audience. Mm-hmm. With this package, they felt they needed somebody to kind of jazz up the
movie. Well, you made fun of the movies a little bit, because he even called them rotten movies.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right.
And a lot of them were. Sad. Right. But they were fun to watch. I mean, you know.
No, well, we only got about a minute left. And I want to thank Ted.
And we're all going to die.
Okay. And Mark Yurkiw. Well, that's probably a true statement.
Right.
Eventually.
And you guys are the authors of From Shock Theater to Svengoolie about Chicago horror films. And we got to have you back on because we got about almost another half hour of clips.
Great.
Oh, right. Some great topics, and we probably should move into the 70s and 80s at some point.
It's a all big subject, yes.
We could do a mini series, you know, and cool.
That'd be and here right. we have, what is this song again?
Rumble by Link Ray.
No, this one is Experiment
Terror. Terror, that's right.
By Henry Mancini.
Henry Mancini.
And Quentin Tarantino uses it.
Yes.
Yes.
In Pulp Fiction, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I think Dust to Dawn also, maybe
Dust
a month.
Right.
Thank you for watching. Frank Gobble, your host. Goodbye. God bless.